डायरेक्टर जनरल प्रोफेसर श्रीवास्तव, अ वेरी डियर फ्रेंड ऑफ माइन प्रोफेसर जैन, प्रोफेसर लहरी, फैकल्टी ऑफ एमिटी, वेरी डियर स्टूडेंट, लेडीज एंड जेंटलमैन, पीपल फ्रॉम द मीडिया इफ दे आर देयर, a very good afternoon to all of you and very warm personal greetings. I and Professor Srivastava have been known to each other surely for more than a decade, and we surely have had a very cordial relation, and I think he has been very generous with respect to his kind words. I think all of you would agree that Professor Srivastava, besides being a scientist and an able administrator, is a very fine human being, and it is this niceties that he has that he moves the people, and therefore it's indeed an honor for me to be here in Amethi and share some of our research work. I do not know how will I going to adjust the time. I asked him how much time would you like me to use, and very politely he says you can finish off your lecture by 1:30. So I am left with 35 minutes to do the job, but trust me, I will do the job. I'll finish it off by 1:29, no problem. Friends, the lecture that I have brought with me today has 100 slides. So the talk can be extended all the way to 2 hours, but nevertheless, I also know how to pack, and I'm very good in packing my own material. As you may notice, the topic is very broad: genome analysis from human to non-human system, applications and implications. And deliberately, I invited trouble for myself with the happy assumption that let us see how much I can run in the open field. If you look at the human genome, we have close to about 3.5 billion sequences, 46 different types of chromosome, 24 types, 22 autosome, 1 X chromosome, 1 Y chromosome. And very interesting thing that you see in human is that for a long time it was known that it doesn't have lot of genes. Why am I going to talk about human Y chromosome? I have lot of interesting things to share with you how exactly it is useful in the area of biology, medicine, and including forensic science. The human Y chromosome is smaller than X chromosome, and therefore by default women on earth have close to about 200 million sequences more. And if the women are ahead of men, are able to do better job than men should not feel small and inferior, because it is mother nature to be blamed, so to say, that they have got 200 million more sequences. Go and cry in front of God. Why is it that you made me small? So the message is loud and clear that, hey, don't mess up, be respectful to female. There you go, human Y chromosome, human X chromosome, 2X chromosome. And you know, Y is like Cocker Spaniel, a French breed of dog, just sitting. Look at this. Look at this. This is from nature, not mine. I have stolen. Everything is fair in research and cricket. Now, let us be little more serious. Human Y chromosome, about which I said not many genes are there, turn out to be so very enigmatic and very smart that it not only has gene, there are multiple copies of gene. For example, if you look at this, you cannot possibly read, but I can read for you because I remember everything by heart. TTTY, TTTY1, Y2, Y3, and so on and so forth, all the way to TTTY5. Every single transcript, testis specific transcript, have 4 or 5 copies. TTTY5 has 35 copies, all of them transcribed. That gave us long ago a clue as to how to go about looking at the copy number variation, which possibly is one of the mechanisms that gene conversion takes place and so on. And if you look at this, you have DAS gene, very important for fertility, and DAS has 4 copies, DAS1, DAS2, DAS3, DAS4. We have literally tried to dissect and see how exactly the genes are arranged in the Indian scenario and which way they are different. The human Y chromosome has close to about 22.5 million sequences, which are making a major part of palindrome, that is palindromic sequence P1, P2, P3, P4, P5, P6, P7, P8. If you add up all of them, it makes 22.5 million sequences. This is centromere, this is short R, and you have all kind of genes located in here. These palindromic sequences are supposed to maintain a structural integrity of the Y chromosome. You can ask a question. If these palindromic sequences are there to maintain the structural and functional integrity of the Y chromosome, why is it that we have trouble like XYY male, recurrent spontaneous abortion, Klinefelter syndrome, Turner syndrome, so on and so forth? And the answer is that if you have a traffic constable at the crossroad, it is not guaranteed that one car will not bump the other car. You can always have a smart driver, you know, they will take a wrong turn always. So palindromic sequences do play a very important role, and I'll share with you what we did long ago. We took 5 regions of the Y chromosome, as you can see from this cartoon, in a manner that they encompass both the arms of the Y chromosome, and we started screening the sample. And for sample screening, we used something called polymerase chain reaction approach. But for DYZ1, we used something called synthetic oligoprobe O8020Y. This particular region that you see, DYZ1, has a very interesting story. I'll share in a minute or so. In 1976, a British scientist, not British actually, Scottish scientist, Howard Cook, published a paper in Nature showing that if you take male and female genomic DNA cut with restriction enzyme HE3, run on the agarose gel, you get 3.4 kb band, which is not there in the female. Remember, the sequencing technology was developed in year 1977, but nobody tried to clone and sequence DYZ1 till a Japanese scientist, Nakahori, in 84, cloned and sequenced and published in Nucleic Acid Research. So we know these sequences. One array of DYZ1 has trimeric repeat TTCCA, 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 and if you count this repeat in one array, this is 229 TTCCA. If you count this repeat in another array, it is not going to be 229. That means simply by looking at this statistically, you can have a marker system that you can use for DNA fingerprinting. And I know I'm going to make a statement which will not be very convincing for you, but trust me, take my words. You do that in identical twin, they are going to be different. How? I'll show you that, and you will agree. Now, this is the PCR approach. You have male and female. You see these markers. They show only signals in the male, but not in the female. These are patient. Phenotypic female P20 has signal. Logically, you expect this to be female, but showing signal means should be male. Why? Because there's a problem at the gene level. This is the hybridization. This slide is 23 years old. Today we know a lot about it. If you take the genomic DNA cut with E3 enzyme, use TTCCA synthetic oligo end-labeled radioactive probe, you'll have band only in the male but not in the female. If you argue with me why you have this, well, if you watch the blot, it will disappear. This is obviously useful in the context of forensic sciences, because the signal that you see does not at all appear in any of the non-human system. only for human system. And this is so very agile sequence, devised one, that even two brothers have different allelic variation. You can see here, for example, a stronger signal, you have less signal. You can argue that more DNA, because of which you have more signal. That's not true, because then logically you expect more signal in here also. This is Cepp family DNA. All over the world, people use for a study. This number 102 signifies that you have Venezuelan family whose DNA are made available through Center of DNA Polymorphism in France. You can buy commercially. Another interesting story, if you are working in the area of forensic sciences, if somebody sends you a sample, you don't know how to find out whether the sample comes from blood or from semen. There is no technology. Trust me, take my words. Go for Google search. Accidentally, we happen to see that same individual's blood and semen sample, there is a difference. In the case of semen sample, you have a band of 400 base pair, which is not there in the case of blood. And this has a chemistry and physics and biotechnology behind. But how a simple observation of biology can be put to use for applied aspect, and therefore it can be used in forensic sciences. And if you look at this, this becomes, this little observation becomes a marker system. I'll run through this. DYZ1 has a tendency at time to jump from the Y chromosome to autosome. You can see two signals from the Y and two signals on the autosome. And all these things that we saw, we realized that looks like DYZ1 is the long arm of Y chromosome. It does have a lot of things to interact with Y, and therefore it must be analyzed in the context of human genetic diseases. Just an example to show you, I got this blood sample from a newly born baby who died immediately after birth. We cultured and prepared the chromosome, and you see some of the cells do not even have this signal. This is because this is a very high level of case of Y chromosome mosaicism. We published, together with other data, in Molecular Human Reproduction, Oxford University Press. The editor of the journal put this picture on the cover page of the journal. We were not aware, so we felt happy. The paper appeared in Molecular Human Reproduction. But then when we analyzed large number of sample of different categories like Turner, Swire, repeated abortion, Klinefelter, XY, female, and so on, two things emerged. One, that clinically speaking, if you put two samples in the same category, genetically speaking, they are not going to be same. Therefore, you have a lot of variation with respect to genotype and phenotype. And as I said, we published yet another paper in Molecular Human Reproduction. And then immediately after that, we went for organizational variation of DYZ1, and then we talked about its diagnostic potential. This appeared in DNA and Cell Biology. And if you look at this, this has a lot of sort of usefulness in the area of human genetics. We got another paper where we used prostate cancer and other samples when we showed that genomic instability of the DYZ1 repeat in patient with Y chromosome anomalies in male and males exposed to natural background radiation. And this DNA research is again from Oxford University Press that gave us a clue that each time you analyze the Y chromosome, you end up having some new additional information. There are changes in genetics that escape our attention. How to go about that? For example, if a gene becomes multiple copies, how will you know? The fluorescence in situ hybridization alone will not tell you. But if you couple fluorescence in situ hybridization with real-time PCR, it works very well. You see, if you have PCR 10 copies and PCR 50 copies, you cannot possibly know whether it is 10 copy or 50 copy. For that, you need to use real-time PCR. And real-time PCR is a technique where you have multiple sample serial dilution. And you can see if pipetting error is there, slightest pipetting error, the block will not overlap. This is the ideal pipetting, just to share with you, the student particularly who wants to experience that. Everybody knows chemistry used the Stegman and Cyber Green. This is how it works. The beauty of real-time PCR is that you have RNase P gene on the autosome, which obviously is diploid, and SRY is a single gene because Y chromosome is present only once in the genome. So you can see, compared to SRY, RNase P two copies, and based on this, you can go for copy number calculation. We used close to about 700 human DNA sample from males, of which 350 samples came from Kerala, where people live close to natural background radiation. The remaining samples were from Delhi and other places, used as a control. And we found out that our analysis has put us in direct touch with the Y chromosome in a manner that human Y chromosome has shown unequivocally there is a very powerful innate mechanism to protect the human genome from the natural background radiation, because the changes whatsoever that take place, they are confined only to the somatic tissues and not to the germline. And when we started observing these, which we started, you know, accumulating in the form of data, we realized that something is extraordinarily powerful. And this paper appeared, tandem duplication and copy number polymorphism of the SRY gene in patient with sex chromosome related anomalies, and also males exposed to natural background radiation. This is molecular human reproduction, yet another paper. And then we went for correlation of the real-time PCR with fluorescence. You can see a single representative slide. We have got SRY copies, eight copies of SRY. This is the centromeric alphoid sequence of the X chromosome. This is Y chromosome. Very pretty, aesthetically pleasing picture. I don't know if you like it, but I like it very much. This is the story of the DAS gene. You can look at the complexity and gene arrangement, DAS1, DAS2, DAS3, DAS4. We have got fish picture for all these genes, which I am not going to show you. This is a screening, and you can see that only the blood sample shows at times the microdeletion of the Y chromosome, but not the semen sample DNA. Just one single slide to show you. And this is a comprehensive and comparative diagrammatic illustration. You can see the microdeletion, and this you can patent if you want, consistently showing deletion. This is a picture showing the extraordinarily interesting thing in the literature so far. Globally, people have reported if DYZ1, for example, duplicates, you always have 2 multiplied by 4 is equal to 8. So you have 8 copies of DYZ1. We observed DYZ1, 6 copy, one side it got duplicated, so 2 became 4, the other side remained unchanged. So you got 6 copies. This is a very interesting observation. Of course, it's a published one now. And this is the scheme for the entire DAS fish picture, that you have 18 EA, A probe here sitting, B probe is here, and C probe is here. We have the cosmic probe available commercially to use for that matter. And these are some of the fish, representative fish picture that you can see using different kinds of probe like A, B, C, D, and so on and so forth. Look at this picture. A series of probes were used. You can imagine the patients scheduled that you need to work along this line, only Y chromosome, and so on and so forth. These are all published. This paper obviously came in PLOS, and I'll share with you. The most exciting part of the research that we uncovered or discovered was a fact that inter-DAS region was localized on the short arm of human Y chromosome, something that Europeans refused to accept our manuscript. And we were given very tough time, so much so that I requested my mentor in Germany to give me some human male metaphase chromosome and DNA to be able for us to demonstrate that what we are talking is true. Anyway, this is the inter-DAS region. This is the global picture in the database. This is the picture that we uncovered. When we tried to publish this, the manuscript was rejected. Why? Because inter-DAS that you see in here, Europeans never believed, Americans don't believe. Their philosophy was that how can entire human genome was sequenced and somebody sitting all over the places in Europe and USA has missed this point. And our argument was that human Y chromosome map was made on the basis of one Caucasian sample. Nobody ever tried to look at it, what the hell is going on? And if accidentally we discovered something, that does not mean it should be brushed aside. To cut the longest story short, from the literature we provided evidence that in orangutan and chimpanzee, DAS still is present on the short arm of Y chromosome. Still it never convinced them. So finally, I brought the chromosome picture from Germany. I went personally and then we conducted fish, and you can see aesthetically very pleasing the inter-DAS sequences present here on the short arm of Y chromosome. And this paper we published in Chromosome Research. Now this is another paper related to natural background radiation. And when this data appeared, Jayaraman, who writes for Nature from India, he picked up this published paper and made an article. This, by the way, this slide also had my photograph. So my student removed the photograph. They say that audience will run away. Don't scare them. So I said, all right, because you know, if you are a smart supervisor or you are a dumb supervisor, get your slide made by a student. If the slides are all right, you can get away by saying, okay, I made it. If the slides are by chance having some mistakes, you can say, well, my student made it, so, you know. So these slides were made by a student, but no mistakes, huh? Anyway, natural radiation poses no major risk. This also came by a meeting in Madras, Chennai, where people from media took my interview, and British scientists were there. They were feeling not so happy because I said, well, this is what it is. And I said so because a series of papers we published also in journals coming from Oxford University Press, so it was nice. Now, this startling mosaicism of the Y chromosome and tandem duplication of SRY and DAS gene in patient with Turner syndrome, this paper appeared in PLOS ONE. We also published paper in PLOS ONE, another one, unique signature of the natural background radiation on the human Y chromosome from Kerala, India. Remember, there are other parts in the world where you have natural background radiation, like one place in Iran, Ramsar. But there the molecular signature on the genome is very different. We published the inter-DAS paper, like I say, in Chromosome Research, saying AZFC region of the Y chromosome shows singular structural organization. It was hell of a difficult job for us to publish this paper. But I like to take panga with the publisher because that gives us a lot of satisfaction, you know. Doing science in India is a lot of fun, actually. You can annoy your director will annoy you, you can have all kind of politics. And then using Indian bijli pani and little money from the funding body, they think that they are giving you charity. Like if you get the money from DBT, the DBT clerk and babus think that they are doing a favor to you. They are giving you blanket free of cost in this cold winter. But then when you publish the paper, the kind of kick and happiness that you have, trust me, anytime, it is better than anything that you do in life, and I enjoy that. Now I'm going to, as I promised, by 129, I'll be done. I'm going to now tell you something very new and very different. So I'm not going to change the vehicle. You all must have heard. Almost 25 years ago, Sir Alec John Jeffrey published paper in Nature saying DNA fingerprinting. If you recall his publication, you would realize that he showed multi-locus polymorphic band. What does that mean? That means the mini-satellite sequences which he used as a probe, they are binding in the genome at different places, on different parts of the chromosome. So we realized, if Alec Jeffrey can do DNA fingerprinting, why not we do RNA fingerprinting, mRNA fingerprinting? And not that I am trying to make any claim. In fact, I feel very uncomfortable when anybody says nice things about me. But sitting in Germany as a Humboldt Fellow, we published also a paper in Human Genetics long ago in 86. Using short synthetic oligodeoxyribonucleotide probe showing DNA fingerprinting. That paper was quoted always when Jeffrey's paper was quoted. So you can always see Ali Muller-Eplin, that paper all over the places. Anyway, that's not important point. The important point is that the so-called mini-satellite sequences that we have, they are present in the genome and they are present at different chromosomes. So this is the background and the sequences are like this. So if you, for example, use an oligo, 16 or 20 base long, and something like this, like green one, you are able to access the sequences on this side and on this side. And the reaction will run because you are using cDNA as a template. This cDNA as a template means most likely you are accessing the functional gene. And because of the fact that no technique is available today which allows you to get the full-length cDNA, so you have to monkey around in the lab to be able to use 3 prime, 5 prime rest to get the full-length sequence. Here also you play the same trick. But this change of synthetic oligo from this to this to this to this, you are able to access a large number of genes. And imagine if you have biopsied cancer sample, your profile of the mRNA that you develop will be different compared to any other tissues. If you have a cell line, B cell, T cell, Burkitt lymphoma, this, that, blah, 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 and so on. We made use of this simple logic. And we used this very simple thing that you take the, choose the tissue, you have total RNA, convert into cDNA, and then you conduct the reaction, resolve on the agarose gel, cut the clone, sequence, and then go for blastocyst. This is a typical gel picture. This is the Masar reaction. This is the, after when you have got these sequences, you see that gene bank shows the sequence homology. So a clone, for example, of 324 base pair shows sequence homology with all this gene. Remember this. And the level of homology is always more than 80%. That means statistically it is very significant. So by using this trick, we have been able to isolate several genes, of which some of them we characterized, of which a few I'm going to talk about here. When once you have the gene sequence, you can do RT-PCR, dot blood hybridization, and you can monitor real-time expression. For example, adenylate kinase-like gene showed maximum expression in testis, least expression in lung. This is the actual real-time picture. This is the amplification plot that you see here. Similarly, another gene, yet another gene, yet another gene, yet another gene. This is how, you know, lecture can be condensed. And another gene, very small, is important, that is secreted modular calcium binding gene that we isolated from buffalo. By the way, SMOC is a protein that my friend who lived could have told you this is involved in bone mineralization, calcium metabolism. Obviously has to do something also with osteoporosis. Not much time, so I'll try to be brief. We isolated full length gene by doing all this jugglery and ended up having something called, also localized this gene, showed its expression, characterized in different tissues, and eventually we published paper showing that the gene has two variants of same mRNA transcript, except of course one variant has shorter 3 prime UTR, the other variant has much bigger 3 prime UTR. Both of them are transcribing. Now, this is the work which actually was started from buffalo. And then it was taken all the way to human system and flip-flop and so on. It forms a very rich source of functional and comparative genomics. This came in BMC genomics. We also try to ask a question, why not we can make the cDNA from the semen sample of buffalo and conduct the same reaction and see what happens. And you see, we used buffalo as a model and we got 84 amplicons, cut, cloned, eluted, and we got a large number of genes, and finally we got a very massive information. From these clones, you can see their level of expression in different tissues. And this is the level of expression in spermatozoa. In the area of animal biotechnology, all over the world, people are wanting to have a biomarker, a molecular marker, to be able for them to detect something called genetically superior bull, so that they can have genetically superior germ plasm. We have been working quietly, politely, not so politely though. We know that if you have 400-500 genes and take these cDNA sequences, align them of one breed, of another breed, of another breed, of another breed, and of those animals which do not belong to a given breed, Trust me, you will be able to segregate this difference at gene level, and that will be your marker system. Anyway, now this is the level of expression by real time PCR. You can see highest expression in spermatozoa. This is extraordinarily amazing that we have got the gene that show highest expression in spermatozoa, and of course in other tissues also. You can see some tissues do not show expression. And when we try to translate this into molecular diagnosis for the human, also cancer biology, the result was extraordinarily amazing. One student in my lab, Masum, is working on meningioma and another what we call glioma, and she has very recently uploaded the paper. We don't know the fate of the publication. So this mini satellite associated sequence amplification that you see taking the cDNA from the spermatozoa buffalo, that paper came in BMC Genomics, expression of dynamics of mini satellite 33.15 tag spermatogonial transcriptome in buffalo bubalis bubalis. Yet another paper we published, GATA, GSE, organization and differential expression of these sequences tagged with somatic and spermatozoal transcriptome in buffalo bubalis bubalis. You know, when your work is noticed by people in USA and Europe, you feel happy. But if somebody sitting in USA uses kind words, you really feel very happy. This is the article appeared in International Journal of Biological Sciences, written by Brazilian scientists and one American scientist, James Womack, who is father of animal genetics, and he has been instrumental in doing the sequencing of the cattle genome. He talked about our work, National Institute of Immunology. You see here, National Institute of Immunology. In this publication, he has used our institute name twice. He says maximum work was done from Japan and India. And then he put our work on two pages. Look at this, all these things that we did. So I gave a copy of this to my director. It was very nice to see that they not only noticed, they used kind words to say that buffalo, science of buffalo has come of an age. And we use buffalo only as a model system, by the way. Buffalo is not my love, but yes, genetics is my love. You are laughing at buffalo or at me? If you are laughing at me, thank you very much. Now, since you are laughing at buffalo, then I'll share with you. Aishwarya Rai picture comes on the cover page magazine. I took a vow that I will put buffalo picture on the cover page of the journal, and DNA cell biology paper, when it was published, I'm serious, the editor says, "Dear Professor Ali, could you kindly send a picture of the animal we want to put on the cover page?" So we took the camera and roam around in Katwariya Sarai in the area and got a buffalo. We took the picture and sent it to USA, and the picture, buffalo picture, came on the cover page of the journal. So my student told that don't ever argue with Dr. Sher Ali. He's a very ziddy person. If he decides to put picture of buffalo on the cover page of the scientific journal, he will make it. And I'm very happy it happens, right? So let us give some respect to buffalo. Now, like I say, if you change the oligo, you can change the whole profile of transcriptome. I still have 3 minutes, don't worry. I promise, I'll be nice. So when once you have done this, you can change the profile, and this is the MASA profile. This is another MASA profile, another tissue, another oligo. And of course, at times we isolate the gene, and for heck of it, we localize on the chromosome. So this is TSPY. Look at the beautiful picture, TSPY. So only one signal on the chromosome, okay? And this is the mess, alignment, molecular biology. Cannot read anything, so do I. But trust me, take my words. This TSPY gene is unique in every species. And germline genetic system, when we did in the human, normal oligospermia, azeospermia, lot of work. In one slide I'm summarizing, we got 60 nucleotide deletion, but not in the normal one. You see how powerful this approach is in the context of fertility and infertility. You can have all kind of applications and implications. For example, if the baby in the womb in a mother is growing, you don't know what all genes are active. So you go for non-human system like fish, different stages of development, and you can do the MASA and you can have all the genes and then do blast search, and then you will see that a lot of genes are showing homology with the human system. And you can go and trace back, and then you see how exactly functional and comparative genomics from animal is going to work non-human system. And biomedical application of MASA is enormous. So far we have used gene expression from different sources, and finally we have been able to isolate 27 genes without screening this cDNA library. So you can say this is a nice and neat things, and thank you very much.